I'm going to put this just, if you can remember where my score is. Hello!
Hello!
We're playing Carcassonne.
Yeah, and it's not really working out.
No, that's because Shut Up and Sit Down is a show about board and card games that you can play in your very own home.
But not in a car.
No, that would be folly. Quinns, if we're playing, who's driving? If we're playing.
You're dreaming, Paul. Oh. Why don't you have another drink?
Yeah, sure.
Oh, the Carcassonne box can't drive a car.
Paul, get up. We have to do the episode.
But what if that really was your problem? What if you did live in some hobbit hole of a home, or you had a reduced amount of living space? What's the solution then? Travel Carcassonne? Travel Descent? No. Card games are your solution, and this episode will see three very interesting examples of that genre. A genre that isn't quite as table-conquering as some others. Good night, Mr. Bear.
Hey, Paul, have you got the limes for those cocktails yet?
Quinns, well, no, I didn't buy the limes. I had my credit card with me, so I ordered them online. They'll turn up later, it's fine.
You ordered them online?
Look, it's a bit complicated, okay? It turned out I had more money than I thought I did. So I went to buy those pants that you wanted. You know those pants?
You got the pants I wanted.
I then put those pants on.
Hang on, wait, you wore my pants?
And then the pants actually really impressed a builder. And so I had the builder with me, and then the builder really impressed a banker. So I was able to use the banker to get a loan, and then I used that just to buy the lime shop.
What?
But then I thought, why have a lime shop? And I used the builder, because the builder was still with me, and he was able to turn the thing, you know, into a nightclub. So now we've got a nightclub. Then the nightclub attracted about 40 women. And then I can probably use some of those women again. I don't know when they're going to turn up, but they'll give me like a flow of extra cash. And basically now we've got some women, and I think when some more money comes in from them, I might use that money just to buy some more money. Yeah. Dominion is a sort of collectible card game that imagines the players as medieval landlords competing for land, territory, provinces, trying to steal them from one another. Now, does that sound boring? No. When Dominion came out, when it exploded onto the scene in 2008, there was enormous reception. It already has 5 expansions out there, another one on the way, because there is so much love for this game already. Now, when I say something like collectible card game, you could be thinking of Pokemon or Magic the Gathering. Well, Magic has a lot to answer for. It made you think that card gaming had to be collectible, that you had to keep buying booster packs and more decks just to make yourself more powerful, to compete with the other players, to keep yourself diverse and interesting, until eventually you're running out of money and suddenly you find yourself with your hand in your mother's purse and you're reaching and just trying to get some change, and she says, "Paul, what are you doing?" And Well, don't worry, Dominion isn't like that. While it is somewhat collectible, it actually exists as self-contained box sets. What's in these? Well, the players will select from this selection 10 decks of cards that they'll put in the center of the table and that they'll all play with. Now, Dominion's a deck-building game. What's that? Well, know that before Dominion came out, that term didn't exist. This actually coined the term, coined the genre. There are now many competitors out there. Deck building is, well, it works like this. You'll start with a tiny hand of pretty weak cards. There'll be a bit of money in there. Every turn you'll draw 5 cards, and your objective is, with whatever cash you have, to try and buy something from the center of the table. The idea eventually is to collect more and more cards until you turn your hand into a land-grabbing machine.
Now, how adorable is this? All of the rules in Dominion break down to an ABC called Action Buy Cleanup. Your action is just playing a special card from your hand for a special effect. Your buying is using any money in your hand to buy a new card from the center. And your cleanup is discarding your whole hand and reshuffling your discard pile into a new deck, if you have to. The first and most impressive thing about Dominion is how easy it is to teach people. I just taught you the entire game just then. Do you remember? You're buying is using any money in your hand to buy. But never mind rules. The deck building game has an almost chemical appeal to the part of the human brain that enjoys watching our belongings grow. As you play Dominion, you'll be watching your thin, pasty deck grow stronger, taller. Imagine Dominion players as chefs, watching each other jealously. On every turn, you'll pick one ingredient to throw into your stew.
Now, you heard Quinns talk about an action phase. Well, this is key. This action phase allows you to play one of these action cards, like, oh, maybe this one. This bridge allows you to buy one more card and also have one extra point of gold. This upgrade card allows you to play another card and have another action. Well, this mining card allows you to play another card and have another two actions. And, well, hang on, can you see what's happening here? Your action phase can become as complicated as your deck allows and as your imagination allows.
So, a few turns into the game, and your turn might go a little something like this. So, first off, you play, look at that, you'll play a mining village. That'll let you have two more actions and an extra card. And then, oh, so you've got your two more actions, you'll play a bridge that'll give you an extra buy and an extra gold, and a coppersmith that'll increase the value of all coppers in your hand by one, letting you buy two decent sized cards. I bet you feel really proud of yourself, for like Billy Big Boots, biggest boy in the borough. Well, I'm not impressed yet. What else you got?
Later in the game, you may have a turn that goes like this. Five cards. Doesn't look like very much money, but I get to have my one action, so I'll play the mining village, gives me another card, another two actions as well. Oh, it's another mining village. That gives me another two actions. I'll play that as one action. I've now got three, another card as well. Ooh, more cash. Well, courtyard now, if I play that card as one of my other actions, I get three more cards. Still got two actions left. I've got two bridges. I'll play the two bridges. They give me more money and they give me more buying options. I'm not going to be buying one card this turn. I'll be buying three cards and I'll be doing it with one, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight cash, the extra cash from the bridges. Ah, the drink of victory.
Now, let's move on to how you win Dominion, and here's the rub. You can build yourself the finest deck your dining room table's ever seen, a paper perpetual motion machine, but all that really matters at the end of the game is how many of these you've bought, victory point cards. Now, these do nothing. They are dead cards. They represent you voluntarily polluting your deck, and every time you insert one of these into your creation, it's like pushing the plunger on a syringe full of sedative. But here's the thing. When this deck of most valuable victory point cards runs out, the game's over. So when somebody buys one of these, there's a real sense of... Ooh, what are you doing?
Well, I'm...
You're buying Stop buying provinces! Suddenly, the game's a race, and with everybody rushing to buy victory point cards, the game ends even faster.
But the most fun thing about Dominion is there's no way to unbalance the game. You can kind of cheat, really, as much as you like. Look, take this card, the Wishing Well, for an example. It allows you, if you can name the next card coming out of your deck, to play it and keep it. Well, that's fantastic. If you had another card around here, and there is one that allowed you to place a card back on top of your deck, you'd know what was coming. You could exploit that. And Dominion's full of this kind of thing. There's no way to unbalance the game because the same cards are always available to everybody, and the same plays, the same ideas you come up with, well, your opponents can copy them in a turn or two's time. What we're playing here is Dominion Intrigue, which is kind of Dominion for jerks. It was a response to the criticism that Dominion's too much of a game about just playing with yourself, building your own deck. Well, now you can interact with all the other players in horribly mean ways. For example, this torturer forces other players to discard cards, or perhaps worse, pick up a curse card instead, which is a victory point penalty, which they've now got in their hand. It's going to come around again sometime, You know what? I don't usually want to talk about education on the show because I feel it's a bit off topic and patronizing and preachy, but kids, if you want an easy sell to your parents, tell them this. Tell them, guys, please buy me Dominion because it teaches the values of thinking logically and thinking laterally and, you know, planning ahead. Seriously, this really is a smart game. It's easy to learn, it's without ambiguities, it's effortless to play, and it has so many possibilities. You know what? Even when you lose, the game doesn't feel really that bad because it just turns out whoever won picked the best combination of actions that time. It's great for young players, it's great for older players, and we've reviewed a lot of good games on this show, but I really think Dominion's the safest pair of hands we've yet covered. Limes. Please stop.
Is that good?
Presses 2,500 years of human history into half an hour of non-stop entertainment. Each player controls a civilization building one of the wonders of the ancient world. You will be expected to get your wonder finished while also building an entire culture around it. And you will do this through a mechanic that is so simple and so rich that I'm inclined to call it genius. A game of Seven Wonders, this is divided into three age. On each age, each player will be given seven of these cards, each of them showing a fine building to build. You'll pick one of them to build, and you will pass the hand on to your neighbor, with the hands going a different direction each age. Now the clever thing is, because everyone does this simultaneously, there's no downtime. Everyone's deciding things all the time. But as the shape of your economy grows and you become more and more aware of what you need to succeed, your opponent will be becoming more and more aware of what they need to hold back from you.
Oh, he's very good when he can explain a game in about 60 seconds, isn't he? Well, just because Seven Wonders is easy to grasp, it doesn't mean it's easy to succeed at. Remember, every time you'll receive a hand of these cards, it'll be one smaller. It's a bit like a noose tightening around the neck of your plans. Well, the art is lovely, I will give it that, definitely looks gorgeous, but receiving these cards is a bit like receiving a poisonous gift. Every smaller hand forces you to think harder about your narrowing options, and all the time while you're trying to think whatever you have to pick to play next, you also want to remember to deny whoever is next to you.
You could very nearly sit down at this table right now for a game of Seven Wonders, but just like Dominion, this game has a touch of ferocity to it, in that it's never entirely clear how to score big. For one thing, you're expected to build your wonder. You can ignore this, but if you choose to build it, you just take a card you don't want, you slide it under there, that's some victory points for you. There are these red military cards, and if you have more of these than your opponent at the end of an age, you can slap them around for points and fun. There are these blue civilian cards, and these just give you bouquets of victory points at the end of the game. You can pursue these entirely and win the game. Fabulous. There are these green technology cards, and the more of each symbol you have, the more points they're worth. Or, for every set of three symbols you have, that's more points. So what cards do you chase? Well, I mean, I'll tell you that when I've worked it out.
Look at this palace. It's magnificent. It's worth so many victory points, but it's also an intimidating structure to try and build because it has so many resource requirements down the side. That's because it's a third age structure. And as the ages go by in Seven Wonders, what is a half hour game and already very pacey gets even more of a sense of intensity and and pace. In the first stage, you'll be scraping around in the dirt like a myopic Neanderthal for any kind of hint of stones and sticks to build your structures with, or you'll be putting together the simplest, most basic things with only a tiny handful of victory points. Really, it raises the question, when do you stop scraping? When do you start building? Then in the second age, everything's doubled. Everything produces twice as many resources, or even bigger piles of gold, or scores you even more points, and maybe, if you built well, you can build things based on top of what you built in the first age. And then the third age comes and the game practically catapults itself off the table. Everything becomes worth enormous amounts of victory points or cash. It can put the rest of your civilization to shame. And you can construct massive fleets which will absolutely demolish your opponents. And providing you remember, you'll also be putting the final lick of paint on your wonder.
I just want to close by talking about how Seven Wonders only lets you interact with your neighbours, because this is cute. You can buy resources, but only from your neighbours. You can go to war, but only with your neighbours. You can pass cards and receive cards, but only to and from your neighbours. And in Age 3, these cards rear their pointy little heads. Guilds. And guilds are worth victory points depending on what your neighbours have built. So you'd end up in rivalry with these guys. But that player sat opposite you could not seem further away. I need bricks, they cry for the fourth time, and you wish you could sell them bricks. And not just to shut them up, you genuinely feel for this guy because he's not your enemy. But you can't sell him bricks because you're separated from him by endless oceans, uncharted jungles, baking deserts. This is an abstract game, but it does give something for hyperactive imaginations to play with. This really does feel like the vast ancient world. Which brings us to the question, should you buy this, or should you buy Dominion? Well, I say, buy them both.
Well, that's a rubbish answer, but it's an almost impossible question. The great thing about Dominion is it can be different every time you play it. Different decks, different combinations of decks, but also, even in just a four-player game, you can spend a while waiting for your turn while people decide, and at the same time, you might want to rush your own turn so you don't keep the other people waiting. In Seven Wonders, the game scales up, even all the way to seven players, so that the action is always simultaneous.
If I were being picky, I'd also point out that Dominion's a crueler game. Everybody runs their own little machine and occasionally throws out an attack card that dicks over some guy in the distance, whereas Seven Wonders is a nice experience. You all feel close together, everybody's passing cards around. It's a hippie game. Dominion is hugely expandable, which isn't to say Seven Wonders is entirely without expansions. This is the Leader's expansion. It adds a mini-age onto the game before the game proper has begun, where you all pick a hand of famous leaders, all with different specialties, to help you out. Leaders essentially gets you to start building before you've started building. Now, listen, anybody out there researching Seven Wonders on the internet thinking this doesn't look rich enough, not complex enough for me, not enough bits, let me tell you, this game is interesting. It is rich, it is complex. I know this game inside and out. You want to play Seven Wonders with me? I will destroy you! And as you're on the floor afterwards begging for mercy, I'm going to say, let's play again with the Leader's expansion, just as you're getting to grips with the base game. And I'm all, boom, Archimedes!
Science in a bath!
That is minus one resource cost for all my scientific structures. It's age two. You're all, Nebuchadnezzar?
Babylon, baby!
Whereas I'm all, boom, Hypatia!
That's philosophy.
Hypatia is plus one victory point to all my scientific structures that are already cheaper. It's age three. You think I'm going all science? You think you know what I'm cooking? You think you know what I'm cooking? I'm cooking a Julius Caesar salad, baby! Never mind the fact that you don't really need to cook a salad. That's plus two extra military shields that wins me the final battle, that wins me the game right here. Oh yeah! All up in your arsenal.
Yeah. Well, hang on, wait, what? All up in my what?
Oh, it's you. I'm knackered. Let's go have a cup of tea.
Yeah.
Off you go.
Hello, I'm Crispy Basket.
And I'm reconsidering my career.
And this is Games News.
One story dominates the headlines this week. Fantasy Flight have announced that they have acquired the Star Wars license. Star Wars has a checkered history with board games, including such trouser-tightening miniature madness as The Queen's Gambit, as well as such buttock gravy as Escape from the Death Star, and the usual terrible Star Wars Risk and Star Wars Monopoly. Can Fantasy Flight turn this trend around? Of course, they must do what they feel is right.
Speaking of Risk, Hasbro have announced yet another glossy regurgitation of the continent-conquering coagulation with Risk Legacy. According to the tagline, every previous game of Risk Legacy will come back to haunt you for the rest of your life. So, like normal Risk then. According to Hasbro, Risk Legacy will include some stickers and some cards, and players will be using these up or throwing them away, as well as writing down the names of other players who have annoyed them. Or something.
Or something. And now for a Games News exclusive interview. Earlier this week, I sat down with famous Gibrovian game designer Yankel Bestoin in our studios to have a chat with him about his upcoming game. Yankel, thank you. It's an honour. Would you mind taking your hat off? This is, after all, television.
No!
Yankel, you're known for your particularly abstract and unusual Euro games. Were you influenced by any German games, past or present?
No. The Germans are much too conservative. In Gibrovia, we push the gaming envelope.
I see.
We push it into your face.
Okay, I understand you have a prototype of your new game. Can you tell us what it's called and what it's about?
Ladies.
And is that what it's called?
Ladies.
What is the objective of the game?
The objective of the game is ladies, and each turn all the players ladies in every dimension.
Right.
The ladies cannot ever face one another because, of course, we know ladies are vicious creatures, but each player may stack them so, and then each player can move them into their lady hive. Of course, it's important to keep your ladies happy and to have enough shops, and if this does not happen, this is where the courtroom board comes into play.
Right. Yankel, could you comment on the rumours that this game was inspired by your recent divorce?
And then you pass the sausage. And then there is the VAR. Prepare for the VAR!
I'm sorry, we'll have to interrupt that broadcast. We've just received breaking news that werewolves and vampires have begun fighting across London. Our reporter is live on the scene. And this is footage being beamed live from the scene now. And that could be a werewolf. Sure that any moment vampires and werewolves will begin fighting. Any moment now.
Oh, hi, I'm sorry I'm late. I just kind of lost what the time was and I couldn't quite find the way here.
How am I doing?
Look,
I've been waiting here for 20 minutes is how I've been doing.
All right, I'm sorry, but I did try and call your phone and you've changed your phone again and I don't know the number and I'm calling
the other one. Yeah, I told you I changed my phone. I told you I changed my phone.
And where were you anyway?
I was at the dentist.
Well then what's the point of me calling you?
To just courtesy, because I've been standing here for 20 minutes.
Where are we going? Because time.
Well, we were going to the steakhouse, but you know that reservation was about half an hour ago.
Listen, I can't have beef. Remember, I can't have beef because it affects.
Oh yeah, because of your delicate system. Yeah, God forbid you get ill.
So don't do this. Don't be like this.
Don't do what? Don't do what?
Ruin the evening.
Ruin the evening after you got so.
We're in public.
Vampires, werewolves, the living dead and the stuff of legend. Well, these things have become passé over the last generation. They've moved from the arena of culture, horror, science fiction, and they've settled themselves in our mainstream. In fact, they've become the elements of teen romance. Vampires were once a metaphor for sadism or rape or the aristocracy bleeding dry the working class. And now we watch them sparkle and shine their way through their pubescent problems. Werewolves have become whiny. Zombies, they're just sad.
Nightfall's theme is that, yet again, vampires are fighting werewolves, are fighting ghouls, are fighting the police, are fighting some kind of sexy goth strumpet outfit, presumably for the right to wear corsets. There are a lot of corsets in Nightfall, more corsets than you would reasonably expect to find in the 18th century. So, Nightfall, it's kind of like a mix between Dominion and Magic the Gathering, those two games we were talking about earlier. Once again, you'll be building your deck. This is a deck-building game. But unlike Dominion, you'll field a little army of troops that you'll be sending off to club the crap out of your opponents. You'll be trying to put wound cards in their decks. And at the end of the game, the player with the least of these wound cards in their deck is the winner.
Nightfall differs from the standard deck building game in two main ways. First of all, at the start of the game, players get to pick their own individual private decks that they draw from exclusively for the whole game. Secondly, it has a chaining mechanic, which is based on the colours of cards you play. Each card in its corner has a moon of a certain colour and one or two other moons of different colours, and those moons determine the colour of the other moon cards that you can play afterwards. Do you see?
It's red. Now, here's the thing. Once you've finished your chain, another player can interrupt. He can chain cards onto your finished chain if he has the colours. Your opponent might just play one card. That doesn't stop you from chaining your entire hand. And then the player next from you can chain even more cards. That poor sucker who thought he was actually just taking his go is going to have to wait, rooted to his chair, because the chain resolves backwards. The last player to put a card on the chain, that happens first. So the player has to sit there watching ghouls rise from their grave and assassins take to the streets. And, well, lots of women appear. Look, even the Olsen twins are in the game.
We're together every day.
It's a really interesting idea. It means that every player has the chance of intercepting or interceding on other people's plays, jumping on the end of their chains. And also, in theory, it means that you'll want to buy as many cards of colours as possible, because you'll want to be able to jump onto the end of any chain that you can. But
the thing with Nightfall,
yeah.
But
what's going on here?
I'm not totally sure.
It's a little bit funny.
Yeah, funny. What do we mean by funny?
We mean funny a bit like in Dr. Strangelove, where Peter Sellers said that general went a bit funny.
Yeah, Nightfall's funny. Kind of like funny biting into a piece of chicken and you're not really sure whether it was cooked or not. If you buy Nightfall today, you're likely to open the box and find a manual with version 1.1 written on it. Version 1.1 for a card game, that's probably not a good sign, and it could do with another version of the manual as well. See, if you visit this URL, you'll find an ongoing rules errata, a cards explanation online. And the reason for that is, well, let's not get into the reason. If you remember our Descent review, you'll remember me pulling 18 pages of errata from between my bum cheeks. That's different. Descent is a massive game with a whole trouser trench of magic items and unique dungeons and special abilities. It's naturally going to get confusing. This is just a card game. Why is it so hard?
And then there's the eccentric nature of the game itself, which manifests itself in a couple of different ways. For example, there's the choice to name cards after individual personalities rather than generic minions. And then the fact that everybody starts with the same deck of these individuals. And these individuals self-chain. And what I mean is, if you play, for example, JJ McTeague, the Cold Wind from Boston, he's a red card and he chains other red cards. So the next person around the table can then play their JJ McTeague, the Cold Wind from Boston, or two, because you'll start with two. So then you've got two JJ McTeagues, the Cold Winds from Bastons. And then you've just got a whole tableau of JJ McTeagues who are all fighting themselves.
But we can live with a bit of surrealness. Strange things happen in the dead of night, as I'm sure you know. What's much harder to deal with is the fact that a game of Nightfall is just very brief. You know, it takes no time whatsoever to put together a force that's going to knock the stuffing out of your opponents, and then the game just ends. When you finish a good game, it ticks over in your mind like an unexploded bomb. You walk away from the house thinking, God, how could I have been so stupid? What did I do wrong? What can I do better next time? You finish a game of Nightfall and you just think, duh, it's over? I guess that was okay?
You know, it's not bad that it's a short experience, not necessarily, but it's a bit weird for a deck building game to be a short game when, you know, you don't have much time to actually build that deck, to customize it and use it. And then there's the further slightly odd aspect of some cards being cards that remain in play, they sit in front of you, others you need to chain again to get their power out of them, others you use them once and they go away forever. JJ McTeague, the Cold Wind from Boston, he's gone, he's blown away. It's obvious, I think, there's a massive disparity between the effectiveness of the cards in the game. Some are very powerful, you'll want to exploit them again and again. Just ignore the others, like for example the ominous power of the Olsen twins.
Work together every day.
In fact, you probably want to buy a couple of cards of the same color and just set them up in a row again and again, and the game just becomes exploitation, becomes the same moves played over and over, and then it's just ended, it's finished, and your friends say, what?
The fact is, we just love board games here at Shut Up and Sit Down, and I think it's easy to forget that, because we spend so much time being preachy or angry or gesticulating like electrocuted semaphore instructors. But, you know, the fact is, we just love board games. They make us think, they make us laugh, they make us happy, and they make us really appreciate our time spent with each other. So, you know, it can be quite disappointing for us when we play a game that's clearly a glossy and expensive product, but, you know, where we can clearly see the cracks, where it hasn't been playtested enough, or at all. You know, most board games are labours of love for the people that make them, so it's a real shame to encounter something like Nightfall that seems rushed out the door, probably in this case to get in on the mad money that surrounds Dominion and the deck building craze. This game, I guess, just wasn't given enough time to mature. Out of its chrysalis into a beautiful butterfly.
Or a vampire bat, but...
Or a butterfly.
All is not lost because AEG, who published Nightfall, also published another game called Thunderstone. It's also deck building, it has a fantasy theme, and it's much, much more solid. Quinz has written a review of it online, which you can read about here.
Somewhere down here.
Somewhere probably. Here. Not like way low down, but...
Yeah.
Yeah. And that's the end of the episode.
Wow.
So, do you want to go for a salad?
Let's go for karaoke!
Hungry Like the Wolf?
No! Anything else? Anything other than Hungry
Bad
Like the Wolf?
Hell.
Oh, okay. Yeah, that sounds pretty good.
I don't want to get back like really late, because you tend to get pissy when the sun comes up.
I burst into flames, all right? For the last time. It's not pissy!
Yeah.
On the next episode, we'll be playing Settlers of Catan.
Settlers of Catan is a trading board game where all of the players represent different colonists trying to build their own villages and towns. Now, the problem is that you have to try and claim resources while...
Quinz, where's my board game gone?
You just... Some things you have to let go.